I'm going to walk through the four critical stages of any AI project: prepare, train, serve, and archive. At each stage, we will look at the workload patterns, translate them into storage requirements, and map them onto a simple evaluation matrix. And to make it concrete, we will be using solutions from Google Cloud as our real-world examples. In fact, let's follow a single story. Imagine we are building a massive foundational model for a major automotive company. This matrix is your blueprint for AI storage strategy, helping you make the right choice every time. All right, let's dive into stage one, prepare. The goal seems simple. Get your raw data ready for training, but this is the stage where many projects get stuck. You are dealing with messy data, different formats, and just huge amounts of it. It all starts with your data stores. In our automotive scenario, this could be a data lake of few petabytes, combining everything from technical manuals and sensor logs to customer service records. From there, you have to get that data into the cloud. Once it's in, the data lands in its raw form in cloud storage. This becomes your main data lake, your single source of truth. And your starting point here is almost always Google Cloud Storage. It's the clear choice because it can grow forever and it's highly durable and affordable. Now, a key way to save money here is using different storage classes. You will use the standard tier for data you are actively processing, but you can automatically move it to cheaper tiers later using features like auto class or lifecycle policy. But raw data is rarely usable. It needs to be transformed, right? This is where you might run a big pipeline using a tool like Apache Parquet to clean the data, handle missing values, and get it into a format that everything can use. And here's an important technique. You don't want to leave this as millions of tiny files. To get ready for the next stage, you should bundle your data into larger chunked formats. While TF record is one option for modern LLM pipelines, formats like Apache Parquet are extremely common and highly efficient. And that leads to the final output of the prepare stage, a clean, organized data set ready to be fed into the fire of model training. So let's summarize the storage requirements for the prepare stage using our blueprint. Capacity needs to be virtually limitless to support a massive data lake. Google Cloud Storage is a perfect fit. Performance, high throughput for ingest is important, but low latency is not the primary concern. So GCS handles this well. Access needs a universal, simple API for easy integration. So GCS's S3 compatible API is the standard. Economics, the main driver is low cost per gigabyte for storing huge amounts of raw data, which is where GCS shines. Okay, on to stage two, train. We have our prepared data, and now it's time to feed a massive cluster of accelerators. The goal is simple, but really hard. Train as fast as possible, because every second those accelerators are idle, you are burning cash. This brings us to our first big decision. You have to look at your workload's specific need. It comes down to three key things: your file sizes, your need for speed, and your application's access requirements. And this leads you to two main paths. Path one is for when you are working with large files, think 50 megabytes or bigger. Here, cloud storage with GCS FUSE is a fantastic choice. It smartly uses your VM's local SSD as a cache, providing file-like semantics. And for workloads that need over a terabyte per second of speed, you can add anywhere cache to make reads even faster. But what if you have the opposite problem? Millions of small files like individual JSON documents from a web scrape where you need the absolute fastest response time for a random reads. Or what if your application has strict file system requirements? That's path two. This is the textbook use case for a high-performance parallel file system like Google Cloud Managed Lustre. It's not just about speed, it's also fully POSIX compliant. Now, what does this actually mean? It means complex operations like file locking or multiple servers writing to the exact same file will work reliably, just like they do on your local Linux machine. Now, the journey of the data from these storage systems to the thousands of accelerator cores is a critical part of the puzzle. I actually covered that entire data path in detail in my first video on this channel. channel inside AI infrastructure. If you want to go deeper on that specific topic, I'll link it for you. So whichever path you take, you end up here, the training loop. This is where the model cycles through the data over and over, slowly learning. And every experiment you run is tracked with a tool like MLflow or weights and biases. Now, when a job runs for weeks, you cannot afford to lose your progress. This is where checkpointing comes. Every so often, the model saves its current state. So if something fails, you can restart from the last save point. For a model of this scale, a single checkpoint can be over a few terabytes in size. The newest frameworks like PyTorch with its latest distributed checkpointing features handles this with a clever asynchronous process. First, the model state is quickly saved to a fast local destination, like the machine's own memory or an SSD. This is the key step because it lets the accelerator get back to training in just a few seconds. Then in the background, a separate process takes that checkpoint and copies it to a durable shared location, like a Lustre file system or Google Cloud storage for long term. And after all that work, you get the prize, your final trained model, ready for the next stage. To recap, the train stage requirements using our blueprint: capacity needs to hold the curated training set, which in our example can be around hundreds of terabytes, say 400 terabytes. Both solutions can scale here. Performance, this is everything. You need extremely high throughput and for many workloads, ultra low latency. Here, Lustre has the clear advantage for small files, low latency workloads. Access, this often requires a fully POSIX compliant parallel file system interface for complex simultaneous reads from many machines. Economic, the driver here is minimizing accelerator idle time. The storage cost is less important than the cost of wasted compute. We have covered a lot here. I would love to know, what's the biggest training bottleneck you have ever faced? Was it storage I/O, networking, or something else? Drop a comment below. I'm really curious. Now you have trained the model, but you cannot serve it efficiently. All that work can go to waste. Next up, serving. The number one goal here, minimize model load time. These models can be huge, often running into a few hundred gigabytes even after optimization. And every second your serving accelerators are waiting is wasted money. So how do you choose your storage? The key questions are, how many serving nodes do you have and how often are you updating the model? This leads to a few options. Path one is for environments that are always changing and have infrequent updates. Here, you would store the model in cloud storage with FUSE. It's a great low-cost choice. Path two is for serving at massive scale, over 100 nodes with infrequent updates. For this, you can load the model onto Google Cloud Hyperdisk ML. Now, this is not a cache. It's a specialized type of block storage that has a unique feature. Hundreds of VMs can attach and read from the same disk all at the same time. This gives you incredibly high aggregate throughput for model loading across your entire serving fleets, which is perfect for this scenario. But what if you are in a research lab or a VFX studio pushing new models every day for frequent updates on 10 to 100 nodes? You would store the model in managed Lustre. Since you might already be using it for training, it's a perfect high performance choice. Whichever storage option you choose, the next step is the same. You load that model onto your serving instance as fast as possible so a high performance inference server can get to work. And finally, the model generates its response, whether that's text, code, or an answer to a question, which is then streamed back to the final application. Let's summarize the serve storage requirement with our blueprint. Capacity needs to hold the model files, which are large, but much smaller than the training data. All options handle this. Performance, the key metric is low latency model loading time. High read throughput is critical. The access pattern is almost entirely read-only. Economics, driven by getting the fastest time to first token and efficiently using your serving instances. So that's the serving stage. What's the biggest generative model you have ever had to deploy? What were the headaches with getting that first token out fast? I would love to hear about it in the comments. And that brings us to our final stage, archive. The project is done, but you're not finished. You need to store all the key assets, the prepared data, the trained models, the checkpoints for the long term. For our car company, this could easily add up to over 10 petabytes or more of critical data over time. The I/O pattern here is simple. Write once, read almost never. The goal is maximum durability at the absolute lowest cost. At this point, the decision is simple. You need cheap and deep storage. This is where the different storage classes of Google Cloud Storage come in. You can pick a class based on how often you think you will need the data. Nearline for monthly access, Coreline for quarterly, and Archive for data you need to keep for years. You can use lifecycle management to set a rule or just enable auto class and let Google handle it for you. And for our final summary, the archive storage blueprint is clear. Capacity needs to be extremely large and durable. GCS is built for this. Performance is not a primary concern. Still, Google Cloud Storage can handle very high throughput and similar latency, even for colder tier classes. Access, the pattern is write once, read rarely. A key benefit of GCS is that you use the same API to access data across all tiers. Economics, driven entirely by the absolute lowest cost per gigabyte. So there you have it, the complete AI storage blueprint. We have seen how at each stage, the storage needs are different and how using the evaluation metrics we looked at can help you match your workload specific needs to the right technology. If you got value out of this, subscribe to Storage Byte. To help you get started, I have put a link in the description below where you can download a copy of the AI storage evaluation metrics that we used throughout this video. Thanks for watching. Thank you.